I think this is an important meeting this morning. You remember, some of you, we have been with BCG, Fanny and Marie and other colleagues from them through three masterclass in end 20 and beginning 21, really around leadership in our new environment, part of it being linked to COVID, but part of it being also to all the transformation we go through, to name it digital, obviously, but also biodiversity, climate, and so on. I think I'm very excited by the session of today, because I think we go to another step, meaning to say, what does that mean for us in detail and very deeply? And for me, the session of today is going to answer indirectly, one question in a concept of business as a force for good. What does that mean to be a leader? And I think that's, for me, a question. We have a tendency to look business as a force for good only on the actions point of view, and not enough maybe on the soft skills and the leadership point of view. So I don't want to be longer than that, except to welcome you. I will stay with you, and we will have a fascinating breakout not too far from now. And immediately I pass the floor to Fanny and Marie.
Good morning, everybody. Pleasure to be back with you on this Leadership Masterclass. First of all, thank you very much to the French INSEAD Alumni Association for inviting us and partnering with BCG on this masterclass about leadership in new reality. And a warm thank you, Claude, to you, who is heading career management for the association, for hosting us today. So I'm Fanny Potier. I'm associate director and partner at BCG. I'm author of A Pro on Leadership in 2020. I'm a former INSEAD MBA, and I am the lead of one of our practice at BCG related to people, change management. I have a long experience in people and leadership strategy consulting, and I am totally convinced that the human factor is at the heart of innovative, agile, and sustainable organization. I pass on to Marie.
Hello, everyone. I'm Marie. I'm a managing director and partner at BCG. I lead people strategy for Western Europe, and I'm a core member of the BCG healthcare and operation practices. Since I joined BCG in 2007, I've developed two pillars in my career, really biopharma and people. And I have supported many leaders in large-scale transformation at international level.
Thank you, Marie. I hear some background noise. So just a couple of logistical points. So this time is for you, and thank you for making it. We invite you to listen with undivided attention. This is an opportunity, as Claude mentioned, to learn and share with others. Can I ask everybody to put themselves on mute? Because I think some of you are not on mute. I hear some noise. We are going to share with you the insights that on the survey, leadership survey that we have run last year. And then, as Claude mentioned, we will have some time together in breakouts in order to deep dive on some of the topics, particularly, as Claude was saying, the heart dimension of leadership. If you would like to ask questions when we go through, contrary to the previous one, we're going through a few slides to share the insights of the survey today. If you want to ask us some questions, please do so in the chat, and we will take them at the end of the few slides that we wanted to share with you. So as Claude mentioned, just a few introduction words before we kick off the formal presentation. So we have started this cycle of masterclass on leadership with a discussion on complexity and how leaders can deal with it. The second masterclass, we have deep dive more specifically on the what of leadership, the leadership threats, right, that are useful to succeed in different leadership situations. And we'll come back to that today. For the third and last masterclass on leadership in the new normal, we have focused on how leaders can support and sustain transformation in their organization. As a closing of our 2021 series, we are delighted, as I was saying, to present to you key insights from a survey that on leadership that we have conducted across 4 countries in Europe, and that was actually complemented by interviews with some experts on the leadership topic. As you can see on the slide, this is quite a thorough survey. It counts 4,000 participants from private and public sector. It was run in 4 European countries that you can see on the slide, and it was conducted by a third party end of last year. We have had about 100 INSEAD alumni participating to the survey, and I wanted to thank them for that. We all realize that the crisis has been a true test for leadership, and as you will see, many leaders have risen to the occasion, bringing much needed clarity, the head, and mobilizing resources against critical actions, the hands. The leaders who stand out have done this while leading and communicating with great care, empathy, and humility with their heart. In the vast majority of cases, leaders now face enormous short-term pressure to improve business results, drive transformation, usually both. A broad set of stakeholders, customers, employees, investors, suppliers, are challenging companies to respond to changing societal values, concerns about climate change and finite natural resources, and economic and political instability. As a result, the criteria and economic models that ensure commercial success are shifting. And successful businesses will be those that meet the needs of as many people as possible, utilize as few resources as possible, and engage with and are responsive to as many of their stakeholders as possible. Big challenge for leaders, right? Companies that attend to all three areas that you see on the slide are nearly 3 times as likely to show sustained breakthrough improvement as those that do not focus deliberately on any of those dimensions. That being said, in normal times, we found that most organizations undergoing transformation quite naturally address the head, 69% of them, as you see on the slide. Slightly less than half, 44%, focus on the hands, and the heart is the most neglected of the three areas. Only 25% of companies focus on it. Major area for improvement. This is probably not new to some of you, and this is partly due to our education that equips us very well for the head, strategic thinking, anticipation of trend, focus on consumer, and somehow for the hands, laying down master plans with action, timelines, etc. But not that much for the heart. However, successful companies depend on people who are engaged and motivated to go above and beyond all of that. People cannot be treated as a means to an end, and particularly after what we have lived in the past year and a half. So I will pass on to Marie that will go through some of the insights coming from the survey.
Thank you. Thank you, Fanny. So the first point coming out of the survey is actually a good news. A good news because 65% of the participants were satisfied with the leaders they had and how they managed the crisis, the COVID crisis. So this survey was done now 6 months ago, as Fanny was saying. So we were still in the middle of the crisis with lots of uncertainty versus and compare where we are today. And seeing these numbers of satisfactions from their leaders is quite satisfactory, because at the end of the day, there could be a lot of comments of blaming from your leaders, but in the crisis, they are still doing good and the perception is good from their employees. Having said that, and if we move to next slide, when we asked people what were the most inspiring leaders that they had, as you can see in this slide, you don't see much people coming from the business world, which is a key and true insight for us. You see people coming as Nelson Mandela, the Dalai Lama, which are more inspiring causes figures, true ethical integrity and humanistic leaders. And then you have historical figures, with the exception of Angela Merkel, that is still a living one, but that is really also comparable, I guess, to the other political leaders that are here, due to the historical and the length of her position in Germany. And then only in the fifth and seventh and sixth position, you have Bill Gates and Steve Jobs, but with numbers 8%, 7% that are much, much lower than Nelson Mandela, as you see, as you see here. There are some differences per country, but not that much in the ranking. You see differences in the country in the next slide, Fanny, where if we ask where the inspiration comes from, it comes from family and friends and good causes. So it's totally correlated to the leaders that inspire people. They are looking for that closeness in their environment and also probably the emotional connection with the leaders that inspire themselves. And the good causes leaders, the people that have a purpose in life and that show this humanity, are also reflecting that for them. Then you have history, and only in fourth position you have business, to the exception of Germany. But as we know, Germany and the industrial network and footprint in Germany is very different from the other countries, where there is much more smaller company, and the connection with the employees can also be different in that extent. So this is really interesting, because as business leaders, for you, it's, I guess, at least for us, it was a key insight that we were not expecting to see that way, and understand, and how to reflect on how we manage people collectively and how we inspire them more in the future, to keep them engaged in what they do in their everyday life. It's completely key. If we move now to next slide. So this is what Fanny was telling you. When we do transformation, and this is what we see with our clients, strategy and execution is usually correctly managed, or at least the right focus is being put on those two things. And from our education, we have all learned to do that, to talk about strategy, and including here in France, it seems that there is an overemphasis on that topic. And then the execution, the planning, all the details, the milestones, etc. But when it comes to heart, even ourselves, we have somehow struggling to take our clients into that journey. And Fanny is leading change management overall for BCG, and she can also see that when you talk about displaying heart, displaying empathy, and generating buying in the company, it's much more difficult. But what do our employees actually ask for? If we move to the next slide, what we see is that employees and participants of the survey across the four countries are asking for heart. The first thing that they're asking and that they are plebisciting is appreciation and recognition. Then empathy, listening, team development. And only after that comes the executional part, the team collaboration, role modeling, adaptation. And after that, the vision, the anticipation, the prioritization. And what is striking for us is not the ranking, because we've seen that coming in the past years, that the heart, everything that is linked to having a people-centric, a human-centric ways of working and ways of managing the company is something that it's a trend that's been coming for a few years. But the spread between the numbers, it's actually increasing, we believe, and COVID has actually crystallized that change in what is expected from leadership. Because as you see, the heart qualities are plebiscited by up to 37% with appreciation and recognition. And the strategic one, when you look at prioritization, it's 14%. So it's a huge spread. That doesn't mean that as a leader, you shouldn't display strategic qualities or executional operational qualities. What we think it means is that if you don't display sufficiently human and heart qualities, people will not be engaged, because strategic and operational and execution is not enough anymore. And COVID has accelerated that shift. And today they are asking for more, for what as an individual they can contribute to the company, how they are recognized and appreciated into the company. They're not asking for being nice, because appreciation recognition is, it's not being nice, because there is some humanity, of course, and some respect into that, but there is also a lot of ambition, because they want to be performing for the best they can bring, and they want the company to recognize that. If we move to the next slide, so here you have the details of the five first qualities that they are asking for: consideration, respect, the well-being and the empathy, the listening, the team development, also the capacity for self-reflection. And we have in next slide some of the quotes of what participants to the survey have told us about this human centricity expectation from leaders. They want them to be open to suggestion. They want to have communication. They want to show respect. They want to show empathy, be motivating. They want to promote professional skills of employees. So as you can see, and it was also surprising, but I'm quite happy that it's actually consideration, appreciation, recognition that came first, and not just empathy. Because again, this is a very complex word and shows the complexity and the high level of expectations that employees have for their companies. They also show the fact that they are engaged, because if they want appreciation from their leaders and consideration, it's because they want to contribute also to the company. So it's difficult for us maybe to hear to that, because it's difficult to show human qualities on an everyday basis when there's a lot of financial pressure. But at the same time, it's a good news, because that means that people are expecting that from leaders, and they are expecting and wanting to contribute to the company. If we look now at what they were asking to their leaders in the crisis specifically, there are two things that changes. The first one is that they ask for more adaptation. And the second, it's communication. So what they wanted from their leaders, and probably what they had, because as I said at the very beginning, they were happy with how their leaders managed throughout the crisis, is that they were there with them, communicating, providing regular information on where the company and where the situation was. And also they had the right flexibility to adapt and manage uncertainties throughout the crisis.
So what's interesting, though, is that having described the expectations on leaders, and they are quite daunting, actually. So if you look at this number, what's really interesting is that people don't want to become a manager, especially non-manager. So there are other ways to be a leader. But in our world, leadership means usually managing people, right? Or there is a degree of managing, influencing people. And this number that you have on the slide, 30% of non-managers want to become a manager, it's actually very stable over time. And we measure that on a regular basis. And it stays in those kind of range. I was actually listening to a podcast yesterday on leadership coming from a research on a similar topic. And they were saying exactly the same thing. And what they found was that, that was their assumption, is that it was based on three specific risks that were deterring people from becoming or from being willing to become leaders. One was the interpersonal risk, so the harm it would cause on your relationship with your existing colleagues, image risk, because a lot of exposure comes with leadership, and also a risk of being blamed, because as you all know, in your leadership capacity, I mean, you take the credit, but you also take the blame. So very interesting insight. The second one, which is good news for the people who were leaning towards thinking that leadership is largely innate. So 64% of the participants believe leadership is partly innate, but can be developed, and particularly in Germany. So this is good news. Marie and I, coming from BCG, we are more leaning towards the fact that you can actually develop your leadership and build muscle over time. So again, good news here. What's interesting as well is that 72% of the participants believe that they should actually drive their own development, and 36% believe that boosting team is one of the main priority for leaders, in complement to this measure that you see on the slide. And one of the things that we were looking for in the survey was, are there some gender differences in many of those questions that we're asking? There are actually very few differences in terms of perception between gender, and particularly on that one. We didn't want to throw too many slides at you this morning. So just pausing here a minute so that maybe you have some questions in relation to the insights that we've shared before we move to a more interactive part of the masterclass. So if you want to ask them, please just unmute yourself and Marie and I can.
I do. Hi, thank you very much. I do have a question regarding the 13% only of people who want to become a manager. Isn't it that becoming a manager is more a consequence of achieving a higher purpose than actually a goal in itself? And if so, isn't it something that, you know, power for itself is not necessarily a good purpose. So isn't it somehow a good news that people are not willing, aiming at management for management, but management as a way to serve a higher purpose? Just a hypothesis.
Well, thank you I'll speak with my heart, if you allow me, because this is an assumption we haven't particularly tested, but we'll come to that. I mean, we're actually so interested in the outcome of the survey and the response we've had to it, because we've shared that with many clients and in many different settings, and the responses have been really rich. On that point, there are two things that we are going to explore further, because we are going to continue this research. It's so interesting and important that we want to go forward with this. It's. I think what I understand is your point, that first of all, there's one assumption that there are two assumptions, right? One is that there may be a shift in terms of vocabulary in the management / leadership space, right? So we may see that some groups working are labeling the content of management with very different words. So that may be part of the explanation of why, you know, it's not attractive. The other thing that we see, to your point, is that historically, the way to grow or to move forward or to be recognized in organization was through moving up the ladders, the hierarchical ladders. And actually, it's quite restrictive just to recognize people that way. And we have a lot of our clients that are actually putting a lot of efforts into developing other ways to recognize people when they want, you know, to grow a little bit beyond their actual suit that they're wearing, and not necessarily, you know, that does not necessarily go through a path where you're labeled a manager, and that's a little bit your point. You know, you can achieve your inner purpose, whether to be recognized differently or to influence people differently with other paths and other labels than just management, right? I don't know if you want to add something, Marie, and I don't know if Alexandra answered the question. But...
No, I agree to what you say. My first reaction is that it's still an issue that this percentage is low, even if at the end of the day, everyone doesn't want and doesn't need to be a manager, but it shows somehow the level of engagement of people on leadership position and on management position in the company. And it is a good proxy for the attractivity of such position in the company and the willingness of them to embark and be more involved in the journey and transformation and growth trajectory of that company. But having said that, you're right, Fanny. We don't want, if we had a 50% people wanting to be a manager in a company, that would also be an issue because you could not be able to provide all these people with managerial position. And you could actually face the problems you're saying, Fanny, that at the end of the day, if you have too many managers, then you have a lot of complexity and you need to provide different paths, as you said, on project management, on expertise, which a lot of companies have now implemented to ensure that you have the right level of management, but also the right level of expertise across the different positions in the company.
Yeah, and just to add to your numbers, I mean, I do, as Marie, a lot of organizational design work, and there are many clients who are working on simplifying, right? And that usually goes through an analysis of their layers, their managerial layers. And when we work on those projects, we usually end up very frequently with the sizing of a managerial track between 15 to 20% max. And that's true for any sector. So in some industry, it may be even lower than that. But even, you know, people intensive industries, such as financial services, I mean, they lean towards that number. So it's, you know, as Marie was saying, it's okay that it's not that significant in a way. Is there...
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Alexandre.
Can I ask another question?
Yeah, sure.
So thanks, Fanny and Marie, for the presentation. Very interested to see the word heart appear in a BCG presentation, a bit unexpected, but on my perspective, very happy about this. But the way I see heart with the criteria you have, it looks a lot, as you say, like soft skills or emotional skills. But I guess if you pick the heart, it's also because it's opening up to other set of values. Here you have empathy, maybe you can go to compassion and some of the words that are normally not used in a company setting. And so my question is, I mean, in my last 10 years of corporate experience, heart, you wouldn't discuss about this. And because a lot of people will believe the company is not the place for heart, it's a personal thing. I believe it's wrong. And I'd like to get your perspective on how much it's becoming possible to discuss about it.
Yeah, so I will start, Fanny. It's a very interesting, even the question, the way you frame it. And with Fanny, we've been discussing that human centricity for now many years. And to be completely honest, and to your point, it's not an easy conversation with our clients, with our colleagues sometimes, on how do you display heart. And maybe it's because, and sorry for that, saying it like that, maybe it's because we're women and we have kids, but a lot of you guys also are parents. So I would use that comparison because I think it's a good one. And I was listening to a podcast that was making correlations between parenting and leadership. And for me, and again, we have, we don't learn how to parent, right? But for me, parenting, it's not babysitting. It's taking a kid and bringing him to his full potential with the qualities and the defaults that he has. But for me, it's always been unacceptable that he doesn't push for what he has, not for what he doesn't have, but for what he has. And when you are in a company, and in fact, when we talk about heart, it's what we're talking about. It's a soft thing, but the outcome, it's a hard thing, if I can say it like that, because it's bringing the people to their full potential. So it's somehow bringing up even to places where they couldn't have been without the help of the manager. Because if they can do that on their own, then as a leader, you don't bring anything. And we are in an environment that has accelerated for many years now. Since I joined the BCG 15 years ago, we were already talking about acceleration, about an environment that was more and more difficult and complex. You've probably been listening to Yves Morieux. The complexity of the world cannot be changed. The complexity of the company, the complicatedness is that can be changed. And this can only be done if you work with your people and if you work with the intelligence and the potential of your people. And this is what we're talking about here. And there is a lot of soft skills like empathy, listening, but there are also some skills that are not that soft because recognition, appreciation, it's a difficult one. It's not being nice, it's not being polite, it's not saying to people what they want to hear. It's something more complex, and this is where it's kind of parenting somehow. How do you tell people something that would develop themselves? How do you bring them to be engaged in a transformation of the company when we know that transformations now are every day, it's not every 5 years, it's a continuous, always on transformation. So this is what we're talking about. And if you put it in this way, it's an easier, still not completely easy, but an easier conversation with the leaders we are supporting and our clients, because you can see the direct link between what we're talking about and the outcome for the company. And they know now for many years, but some of them have realized that also with COVID, that you need to empower your people to the lowest level if you want to be able to manage a difficult situation and transformations of your company.
And I won't necessarily add to that. I just want to pick on a couple of comments that were on the chat. I think, Guillaume, you mentioned vulnerability, and it's true that it's an important point today. And you could put it as role modeling, or it could be places in the heart space. I think one of the things that we are going to do, and perhaps it's a good way to go to the next phase of the session. We want, as I was saying, we want to continue to work on that, right? Because as Marie was saying, there's a big shift in leadership. So we don't want to invent a new leadership model. I mean, we can label things differently, but what we want to continue to explore is those topics, and particularly the heart piece. One thing that we realized, and your feedback is aligned with that, is that worlds are very different, and they are actually, I mean, we know that in communication, they are just putting some meanings, and they are kind of limiting and probably what we mean and what we would mean to each of us with the heart. So that's something that we are going to work on in the next phase of the research, because we will continue to work with the survey, but we also want to work with focus groups and most interactive sessions such as the one we are going to do now, if you're okay with that. Because we'd like to capture, you know, different ways of labeling the same thing that will be used by people. Because, you know, again, the idea is to progress here the science around leadership in order, you know, to move up, I would say, the capability, particularly around the heart. Because one thing that's for sure is that We've worked with many of our clients on future of work now. And I can tell you that for having facilitated a lot of sessions with managers and leaders on that, many, many of you are at a loss of what does it mean, right, in practice, and how to rebuild actually some of that in an environment where there will be some hybrid, where people are completely burned out and exhausted by what we have lived. So it's a very, very important topic. So what we are going to do now, if you're okay, and we can continue the discussion with this setup, Juliana is going to send us in three breakouts. So just technically, I'm sure you're familiar with that, but I prefer to say it again. So join breakout, you need to accept the prompt of joining breakout. So we're going to be there for 40 minutes, and then we will be called back in the plenary. So again, this is an intentional move on your side. We'd like to discuss three things with you in the spirit of this focus group I was mentioning to you. And again, there will be some other discussions. If you think about the discussion, the dimension of head, heart, hands, which top five are the most broken from your perspective and from what you observe in your organization? If we focus on the heart, but not only, it's interesting for the group that you share examples from your professional or personal experience of how you've seen them demonstrated or how you've demonstrated yourself. And we want, because there's an assumption we haven't really discussed, we do believe that there is a set of qualities, you know, for leaders, but you don't necessarily, it's brutal, Eric, cut the middle of your sentence.
Il n'y a pas de cœur dans ce Zoom meeting.
It's only hands and...
It's heartless. It's terrible.
Lack of empathy.
No heart.
I think Fanny and Marie, it was extremely lively, you know, and really going to the heart. And maybe to give you some feedback, and after like that, we have done it. Clearly, in the most broken, or the risk, or the one to be more risky to be broken, maybe, came very strongly the team in all dimensions, collaboration and development. The second one was empathy. Maybe not broken, but facing a higher need. It could look like being at risk. We came also to three other points at the same level. So these first two were top, and after it was appreciation and feedback, listening, and vision and anticipation. And on the second question, if I think there is three words which came out, is caring, attention to emotion, and not only to the brain, but being attentive to the emotion of the people with examples, and in the same spirit, providing positive recognition. And to be very frank, we have not been very much in the last one.
Marie, do you want to summarize?
Yes, so on my hand, the things that came up of being broken was the self-reflection as a leader. And also we were talking a lot about trust, which is not a word that was there, but that is also linked to the self-reflection, the role modeling, the communication, the listening, to actually rebuild the trust that is usually broken in companies, and that endangers a lot of different things. How do you display the heart? We were talking about being honest, transparent, the communication. Also being authentic and having a purpose, a true purpose, not just a vision or a marketing exercise, but building on a true purpose to create this engagement as a system.
Okay, in our group and my group, please feel free to be disruptive there if I don't reflect your contribution. I'm not going to summarize it like that. We were more disruptive. So I think so on the one hand, importance of the heart, etc. And with two comments there. One is that why disconnect heart and head? And also just perhaps take inspiration from, you know, all of what we do and know about being mentor, leader, coach, leader, leader mentor, etc. On the other hand, of the continuum, two watch out, I would say. One is that a leader is part of a system, and the system can be heartless, and that's a reality. And it's in with this assumption in mind, it's extremely difficult to develop a coherent approach within all the dimension that we have on the model that we represented, and also alignment of interests between the different parties that live in a collective and in an organization. So on that note, thank you very much, all of you, for your contribution, lively debates, and we certainly have not finish the discussion on that. Very quickly, as we did for the masterclass, the other masterclass, can you please give us a very instant feedback on how useful the session was for you? I'm going to just to give me a hand, right, with a number of fingers or no hand, and we have a film for has it been useful for you? Okay, thanks. Hands, five, four. Okay, thanks, guys. as I was saying, we are going to continue to engage in this topic, in researching the topic as BCG on the heart in particular. We are going to launch a new cycle of the masterclass probably October, November. We are going to start working on that with Claude very soon, and we'll be happy to see you then. And in between, enjoy your vacation and take some rest. We all need that.
And before the thanks a lot to you, Fanny and Marie. And I think without you, it would not have happened. And it's beautiful. And before vacation, for I come back to our dear association, don't forget for the one who wants, but good you want, to elect your board member of the association in the coming days. You receive a flow of emails. We receive more, believe me. We need your vote to continue to have this lively association. And once again, thanks a lot to you, Marie and Fanny. And thanks to Juliana also to make it happen very well. Have a good day.
We will share one the question. Slides.
We'll share the slides and the recording.
We will send you the slides.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Ciao. Thank you.